get to the point they'll frustrate the colony to the point where they will abandon the hive, they'll fly out. So if there's one predator, it's those bees. So this is like an ultra cheap, quick hive, but at the same time, this is not their permanent home, because what the thing is, this cavity, it's big enough they can survive for a while, but then they're gonna fill the entire thing. They'll be encouraged to make their combs on these bars, but there'll be a point they're gonna start attaching their comb to the sides, and they're gonna want to fill the whole thing with comb. So this really is just a temporary hive that will allow that colony to get established on these bars. And now these bars, I can make a large top bar hive, which I have, that are trough shaped, and they have tapered sides. And all you need to do is just punch in top bar hive on the internet, and they'll be the dimensions, exactly what you want. And it's very specific angle, specific length, and it can be made out of very inexpensive throwaway wood. And it's similar to this, but it's longer, like a trough. So now I ship these to my top bar hive. And I do this for a couple reasons. When you go collect bees, about 50% of the time, the bees fly away. So if someone comes to your place and collects some bees, why they're charging you to take bees out of your valve box or something like that is because there's a 50-50 chance those bees will stay in the hive that beekeeper put them in. And nobody knows why. They just decide, we don't like this spot, we're going to fly away. It doesn't mean that they died or the hive collapsed or anything like that. It's just that they decided there's something about that environment and they flew off. So then 50% of the time you keep them. So what I do is I get them started in a really inexpensive, this is called a nuke or nuclear. So I get them started in a bucket like this. I see that they're building nice comb and it looks good. They're healthy. It's very obvious that they're doing well. Then I shift these to a top bar hive, or I made this to fit this kind of hive too. So I can actually, so these are frames. These are conventional frames. I made this to fit in here. So I can take that hive and shift it to this type of a box. And I don't put those bees in here initially because I'll use up all my bee boxes or top bar hives with possible bees that possibly will make it. And then I'll run out of boxes and I'm waiting to see if they'll get established. But then all of a sudden they either make it or don't make it. It's like a 50-50 chance. So I'd rather have them started here, then I shift them to a permanent box or a permanent top bar hive. So that's why, so there's a lot of, you'll find a lot of beekeepers are really ingenious and really, they do a lot of inventive things on their own. But
Paul, what do you call that insert?
Excuse me?
The insert, what did you call that?
It's called foundation.
Foundation.
Yeah, and you buy this at the beekeeping store. This is just one way to do it. There's about 100 ways. You'll find other people do, they'll just pour a little bead of wax. They'll put a piece of jute string that's been dipped in wax, and they'll staple it to there. So there's this little bead of wax, and it encourages the bees. All the bees that are in the box, now they climb to the top, they hang in a ball. They see that there's some honeycomb right there, and they're, oh, somebody already started the comb right here in this little line. And they'll just naturally start building. And the wax comes from their bodies. They make the wax. They actually extract it out from underneath their plates on their abdomen. That's where beeswax comes from. So, livestock. A number of things you get from hives, obviously, is honey. You get pollen. Bee pollen is a huge business. So this is bee pollen. And you get wax to make wax candles. And you can even buy these real cool little tins and make beeswax candles. That's a science in itself. It's not, you don't just take some honeycomb, melt it, pour it, and you got a candle. It's really difficult, and it took me a long time to figure out how the heck to get this stuff to burn right. It's pretty hard, but you can figure it out. You get propolis. You might have heard of propolis. Propolis is actually tree sap that bees collect from trees, and they seal their hive with it. It's an antiseptic, antifungal, anti-everything. And they seal holes in their hive with it, too. They do multiple things with it. And it can be collected and used as their product. So it's called propolis. It's put in toothpaste and all kinds of things. So, the species of bees, you've probably heard of the colony collapse disorder. There was a, there's a huge controversy in what's going on with that, but there's some new writings that are out, even books on this whole situation. And everything's pointing to where beekeepers knew in the first place, and that was new chemicals and genetically modified crops. New chemicals that came out that were sprayed on crops, factory farm crops, and genetically modified plants. A lot of the plants are modified to the point where they actually have, they're a registered, the crop itself, the corn plant or whatever plant it is, it's a registered pesticide, the plant. It's hard to believe that we've taken science and we've done that with it. It really hasn't helped us as a species. So if the plant is a registered pesticide, what's that going to do to, and these are wind-pollinated crops like corn. So of course all these people are saying, well, bees don't go to corn and get nectar. Bees go to corn and get pollen. All kinds of pollinators go to all kinds of grain crops and they get pollen. Every cell of that plant, pollen grain, whatever, has been spliced with a bacteria that kills the larvae of insects. So, I'm not a scientist, but it's really simple. It's really simple. And we've known it all along, and there's been all kinds of really goofy smoke screens about the cell phone antennas and all kinds of stuff. But it's very, they threw a massive array of propaganda out to cover what was going on. And that's what's going on with the colony collapse disorder.
So the bees don't naturally stay away. They don't stay in
it's spliced into the genes. The plant has no clue that there's a bacteria in it that will grow in their intestine and kill their larvae. Yeah. We wouldn't know. They don't know.
GMOs all the time, and we don't know.
So, question?
Does systemic fertilizer do the same thing?
Oh, yeah. You put systemic fertilizer on your... I shouldn't say systemic fertilizer. No, they're systemic. There's these products put out by companies that have... It's a fertilizer, insecticide, and fungicide, all in one, in a shaker bottle. You put it on your roses. A whole bunch of companies have these things. So they're put out. It's a systemic insecticide. It's sucked up by the roots or absorbed by the foliage. It's in every cell. Every cell of that plant has that insecticide in it. And it kills the bugs. As they chew on it, they die. As the hummingbird drinks the nectar from that, what do you think happens? It's crazy. It's just insane. There's so much of this insanity. It goes across all these different levels of nature. So, do you have a question?
I've actually heard that neem oil is the only organic systemic. I don't know if it's a pesticide or what, but it only just occurred to me before I bring that into my yard. Does that affect bees?
I don't know. Anything that you're going to apply on a plant that's going to kill one bug or repel a bug, it's going to affect some other pollinators. But I'm not saying don't use it. I'm just saying maybe look into it more. So, but I don't. Yeah, I've used neem oil a few times. Bit more.
Mine is just kind of a comment to add on to that. The other thing that I'm a beekeeper, and they see a lot going on in my hives dying off and stuff like that. But what I realized is also just deliberate spraying an insecticide in a hive. Because what happens, let's say the bees are in your home, you spray them out, you're happy you killed that colony, but other bees will come to scavenge the honey and the stuff that's that hive. So you can end up spraying one hive, but you've killed 10 other hives around you, because the bees scavenge the honey that the dead bees left. So that's another thing, that's maybe one hive sprayed means 10 other colonies poisoned or actually wiped out. And it's that way that the chemicals also end up in our honey, because these bees might not die off, but they brought those chemicals into the hive, and it ends up in the honey. So you might not have killed the insects, but now you're consuming the same poison that you thought was helping in your home. So.